Read to Reap. Part 4. Compiled by Hussein Fahmy. The Japanese do solve problems and correct faults, but that is only the beginning of improvement. Then they go on to make better what already seems perfect. Awareness of this approach and loss of market share force the West into a second phase. Phase 2. Quality and continuous improvement. To compete with the Japanese, Western business was forced to move away from the problem-solving phase. You could solve all your problems, but that only brought you back to where you had been. Meanwhile, your competitors were making improvements at points which were not problems, and one day you woke up and found that you had been left far behind. So the West had to set about doing what came more naturally to the Japanese, who never had the negative orientation of thinking. The West had to devise and institute formal quality programs, which were concerned with continuous improvement. This was no longer just a matter of problem solving and fixing defects, but of making better what was already good. So came the notion of quality and continuous improvement. The choice of the word quality is a good one. You can have an adequate suit which performs the functions of a suit, but you can also have a quality suit. With the quality suit, you are still always trying to improve the quality. In addition to everything else, the quality movement set up frameworks such as quality circles or teams, which encouraged people to examine what they were doing instead of just doing it automatically. The motivation value of this was considerable, even if few changes were actually made. There were now two levels of achievement. The first was doing what you were supposed to be doing. The second was attempting to improve the process itself. The quick results trap. In traditional cost cutting or slimming down programs, the big benefits come early. It is not too difficult to get rid of the fat and inefficiencies that have built up over the good years when there was no pressure on costs. But as costs are cut and efficiency is increased, then it becomes more and more difficult to get results. The same thing happens with quality programs. The best results come early, and the more successful the programs, the more difficult it becomes to get big results later. This is when quality programs can become boring. At this point, there is a need to shift to the third phase of business, which is just beginning. Phase 3. Creativity or quality plus. The German economy has thrived to the point where it became the world's largest exporter. This is in spite of very high wage rates and much longer holidays than in other industrial countries, 5 weeks vacation a year. The success of the German economy was based on excellence and high quality, particularly in the field of engineering. This high quality was based on two things. The first thing was a very highly skilled workforce, which comes from a unique apprenticeship system in which workers learn their skills through early on-the-job training. The second thing was a conscious decision to put quality before creativity. The quality, first and only trap. Putting quality before creativity makes a lot of sense. Creativity without quality is not worth much, as US and British industry found when competing with the Germans and the Japanese. Quality without creativity does have a high value. So long as your competitors cannot also offer quality, then you have to go further. That is why German industry may be in bad trouble in the near future, because they have not yet realized that others are catching up on quality. For example, Germany has fallen far behind the electronics area and is seeking to catch up through joint ventures with the Japanese. The limit to quality alone: water is necessary for soup, but soup is more than water. Flavor without water does not make soup. Creativity without quality is of little value, but quality alone is also not enough. The word quality is a good word and implies doing what you are doing better. This is very important and very valid. But making better fountain pens when you should have been switching over to ballpoints may not be the best thing to do. There will always be a niche for high quality expensive fountain pens, but that is a small specialist market. At this point, we come to the chief limitation of the notion of quality. Should we expand quality's definition? I see a very considerable danger in expanding the notion of quality to include everything good that can be done. There is danger in expanding the notion of quality to include their creative change of concept as well. The danger is that when we seek to expand a word beyond its true meaning, we only end up confusing people and also losing the power of the original meaning. There is exactly the same danger in the teaching of critical thinking in schools. The proponents of critical thinking claim that it covers all thinking, which is clearly nonsense. The word critical comes from the Greek kritikos, which means judgment. Indeed, judgment is an important part of thinking, but there is also the need for generative and productive thinking. In the same way, we must not lose the value of the word quality by pretending that it includes all that needs doing. We end up by devaluing that word and not doing all that needs doing. So we need to acknowledge the great value of quality and the continuing need for it. And then we need to add the concept of creativity as well. This is in no sense a criticism of quality or an attack on quality. Recall, if you will, that to point out that flatness of one tire does not attack the full inflation of the other tires. Organization for quality and creativity. Many large organizations are slowly coming to realize the importance of adding creativity to their quality programs. Organization for quality and creativity. This means creativity throughout the organizations and not just in special areas such as marketing, corporate strategy, research and development, etc. It is right that quality should come before creativity, but eventually there comes a time when creativity needs to be added to quality. Some organizations such have started to talk about engineering, which introduces the concept of creativity. Instead of doing the same thing better, is there a different and better way of doing it? Two approaches to company-wide creativity. The toolkit approach. The simplest approach is to seek to introduce creative thinking techniques into the quality programs as tools for achieving continuous improvement and even changing concepts. In this way, the tools become available to everyone working within the framework of the existing quality programs. The introduction of the tools can be done in a format and systematic manner, though properly trained facilitators or trainers. The important point is that it needs to be done seriously and should not just be a token gesture towards creativity with some weak brainstorming sessions. Creativity in all areas is going to be the key ingredient for business success. As technology becomes a commodity and all competitors reach the same level of competence, it is only creativity should not be seen just as a subset of quality or only as a toolkit for quality programs. Creativity needs to exist in its own right in an organization with a nominated champion and, where possible, a creativity center. This creativity center can then provide the training and toolkit for the quality program. Fixing misperceptions about creativity. There is a huge amount of nonsense and rubbish written about creativity. It is a subject which attracts a large number of operators who have loads of style but only incompetently borrowed substance. Much of the confusion arises from some basic misperceptions about creativity. Creativity misperception number one. Artistic creativity and conceptual creativity are the same thing. The word creativity in the English language unfortunately includes the arts. So it is supposed that all artists are creative. This is not so. Many artists are simply productive stylists who produce within a style or perception and expression. This has nothing whatever to do with changing concepts. We need to distinguish clearly between the creativity involved in changing concepts and artistic creativity. Being artistically inclined does not make a person creative or capable of training others in creativity. Creativity misperception number two. Everyone is creative but has been untrained or inhibited by peers. There is a tradition that everyone is really creative and that we have all been inhibited by a school system that demands the one right answer and by the fear of seeming ridiculous. The hope is that if we become liberated and freed from such inhibitions, then we shall all be creative. This is nonsense. The brain is not designed to be creative, and if it were so designed, then life would be impossible. The brain is designed to set up perceptual patterns and to stick to them. To be creative, we have to do things which are not natural and which go against the way the brain is designed to work. So removing inhibitions only has a mild effect. creativity misperception number 3. We need only understand left and right brain functions, and increase right brain thinking. The split between right and left brain had some usefulness in indicating a different sort of thinking, but has since done far more harm than it offered value. The left brain is the educated brain and has learned what things are and how to use language and symbols, etc. The right brain is innocent. This innocence may have value in such areas as drawing and music, but not much value in conceptual matters. PET scans of the brain show that when a person is being creative, both sides of the brain are in use the whole time. There is the added danger of fatalistic categorization: I am left brain, she is right brain, etc. This gives a totally false impression, for creativity can be learned by anyone. Creativity misperception number 4. Brainstorming in a group is the end-all and be-all of creativity. The old idea of brainstorming has held back the development of serious creativity. Brainstorming was developed for the advertising industry, where novelty is sufficient to create value. Everywhere else, novelty has to be turned into something practical. Brainstorming is a very weak technique, and people trained in brainstorming are often unable to deal systematically with new concepts. Because brainstorming is now traditional, it is often felt that creativity requires only a brainstorming session. Brainstorming has also led people to believe that creativity has to be a group process. This is not true. Creative thinking processes can be used by a person entirely on his or her own. Creativity misconception number 5. Creativity and structure don't mix. There is a feeling that creativity is a matter of intuition and inspiration, and that any structural approach is a contradiction in terms. Again, this is nonsense. There are many examples of liberating structures. Language is a liberating structure, which allows us to do things we could not do without it. A cup is a liberating structure that allows us to drink liquids more easily. A ladder is a liberating structure, which allows us to get to new places. A boat is a liberating structure, etc. So also are the systematic tools of creativity and the book MCS that allows us to handle perceptions in novel ways. Mind control system. It was precisely to get away from the vagueness and confusion of the term creativity that the term MCS came. It is specifically concerned with changing concepts and perceptions. A structured approach to creativity. In the end, specific thinking tools must be practical, simple, and powerful. Creative thinking based on the formal and structured use of such tools does not depend on inspiration or being in the right mood. Nor is it a matter of loose brainstorming in the hope that something copes up. The mental operation of movement can be used systematically to get value from provocations. This is totally different from the weak admonition to withhold judgment. Summing up. When quality is poor, there is a need for quality improvement, but as quality improves, there is a need to supplement quality with creative thinking. 4 points come to mind here. 1. There comes a point when we have to wonder whether doing things in a different way may not be more useful than doing things better in the same old way. This applies both to internal operations within an organization and to what the organization has to offer to its market. 2. Competence will not be enough when everyone else is as competent. Water is necessary for soup, but soup is more than water. 3. Creativity can provide a toolkit for quality programs, but creativity needs to exist in its own right within an organization. 4. Generate innovative solutions. Focus your creative energy and turn problems into opportunities. Tap into your creative energy. Add strength to your natural abilities, improving teamwork, productivity, and profit. Think creative on everyday issues. Changing the corporate mindset can be as easy as changing a hat. Replace one-dimensional thinking from emotion to facts, positive to negative, critical to creative. Make your thinking more deliberate and generate more ideas, identify alternatives, stimulate innovation, and solve problems faster. Improve teamwork and have better meetings. Be a visionary, improve quality and outthink your competition using these MCS tools. Simplifying complications is the first essential of success. In an increasingly complex world, simplicity is becoming one of the key values. There is often a much simpler way of doing things, if you make the effort to look for it. Simplicity does not just happen, it has to be inculcated. In MCS you will learn the use and value of simplicity, why people hate simplicity and love complexity, overview of methods, techniques and approaches to simplify, dangers of simplicity and the rules of simplicity. Innovation is the key to survival in this ever-changing and competitive world. Having the leading edge and competitive advantage are insufficient to maintain the marketing position. Innovation ensures that you consolidate and champion your company's products in the do-or-die marketplace. Achieve higher levels of creativity and memory, clearer organization of thoughts, increased concentration and more concise communication improve access to your memory for better recall and retention. Respect, a priceless gift. Respect is an attitude of acknowledging the feelings and interests of another party in a relationship. Respect does not necessarily imply deference, but a respectful attitude rules out unconsidered selfish behavior. Respect is sometimes loosely used as a synonym for politeness or manners, though these are behaviors, whereas respect is an attitude. Intercultural differences in behaviors, self-perception and outward appearance may result in the unintentional appearance of disrespect. Many movements have at different times claimed respect as the core element towards mutual existence. Respect is a feeling of appreciative, polite expressions of consideration, to avoid violation of or interference with, willingness to show consideration or appreciation, the state of being regarded with honor or esteem. Respect is of great importance in everyday life. As children we are taught, one hopes, to respect our parents, teachers, and elders, school rules and traffic laws, family and cultural traditions, other people's feelings and rights, the truth and people's differing opinions. And we come to value respect for such things. When we're older, we may shake our heads, or fists, at people who seem not to have learned to respect them. We develop great respect for people we consider exemplary and lose respect for those we discover to be clay-footed, and so we may try to respect only those who are truly worthy of our respect. We may also come to believe that, at some level, all people are worthy of respect. We may learn that jobs and relationships become unbearable if we receive no respect in them. In certain social milieus we may learn the price of disrespect if we violate the street law, mess with me and you die. Calls to respect this or that are increasingly part of public life. Environmentalists exhort us to respect nature, foes of abortion and capital punishment insist on respect for human life. Members of racial and ethnic minorities and those discriminated against because of their gender, age, religious beliefs, or economic status, demand respect both as social and moral equals and for their cultural differences. And it is widely acknowledged that public debates about such demands should take place under terms of mutual respect. We may learn both that our lives together go better when we respect the things that deserve to be respected and that we should respect some things independently of considerations of how our lives will go. We may also learn that how our lives go depends every bit as much on whether we respect ourselves. The value of self-respect may be something we can take for granted, or we may discover how very important it is when our self-respect is threatened, or we lose it and have to work to regain it, or we have to struggle to develop or maintain it in a hostile environment. Some people find that finally being able to respect themselves is what matters most about getting off welfare, kicking a disgusting habit, or defending something they value. Others, sadly, discover that life is no longer worth living if self-respect is irretrievably lost. It is part of everyday wisdom that respect and self-respect are deeply connected, that it is difficult if not impossible both to respect others if we don't respect ourselves and to respect ourselves if others don't respect us. It is increasingly part of political wisdom both that unjust social institutions can devastatingly damage self-respect and that robust and resilient self-respect can be a potent force in struggles against injustice. The ubiquity and significance of respect and self-respect in everyday life largely explains why philosophers, particularly in moral and political philosophy, have been interested in these two concepts. They turn up in a multiplicity of philosophical contexts, including discussions of justice and equality, injustice and oppression, autonomy and agency, moral and political rights and duties, moral motivation and moral development, cultural diversity and toleration, punishment and political violence. The concepts also play a role in bioethics, the study of the ethical and moral implications of new biological discoveries and biomedical advances, as in the fields of genetic engineering and drug research, environmental ethics, business ethics, workplace ethics, and a host of other applied ethics contexts. Although a wide variety of things are said to deserve respect, contemporary philosophical interest in respect has overwhelmingly been focused on respect for persons. The idea that all persons should be treated with respect simply because they are persons. Respect for persons is a central concept in many ethical theories. Some theories treat it as the very essence of morality and the foundation of all other moral duties and obligations. Despite the widespread acknowledgement of the importance of respect and self-respect in moral and political life and theory, there is no settled agreement in either everyday thinking or philosophical discussion about such issues as how to understand the concepts, what the appropriate objects of respect are, what is involved in respecting various objects, what the conditions are for self-respect, and what the scope is of any moral requirements regarding respect and self-respect. This entry will survey these and related issues. The concept of respect. Among the main questions about respect that philosophers have addressed are these. 1. How should respect in general be understood? A. What category of thing is it? Philosophers have variously identified it as a mode of action, a form of treatment, a motive, an attitude, a feeling, a mode of valuing, a way of attending to things, a moral principle, a duty, an entitlement, a moral virtue, an epistemic, of, relating to, or involving knowledge, cognitive, virtue. Are any of these categories more central than others? B. What are the distinctive elements of respect? C. To what other attitudes, actions, valuings, duties, etc. is respect similar, and with what does it contrast? D. What beliefs, attitudes, emotions, motives, and conduct does respect involve, and with what is it incompatible? 2. What are the appropriate objects of respect, that is, the sorts of things that can be reasonably said to warrant respect? 3. What are the bases or grounds for respect, that is, the features of or facts about objects in virtue of which it is reasonable and perhaps obligatory to respect them? 4. What ways of acting and forbearing to act express or constitute or are regulated by respect? 5. What moral requirements, if any, are there to respect certain types of objects, and what is the scope and theoretical status of such requirements? 6. Are there different levels or degrees of respect? Can an object come to deserve less or no respect? 7. Why is respect morally important? What, if anything, does it add to morality over and above the conduct, attitudes, and character traits required or encouraged by various moral principles or virtues? 8. What are the implications of respect for problematic moral and socio-political issues such as racism and sexism, pornography, privacy, punishment, responses to terrorism, paternalism in healthcare contexts, cultural diversity, affirmative action, abortion, and so on? Elements of respect. It is widely acknowledged that there are different kinds of respect, which complicates the answering of these questions. For example, answers concerning one kind of respect can diverge significantly from those about another kind. Much philosophical work has gone into explicating the differences and links among the various kinds. Before looking at the differences, however, it is useful first to note some elements common among the various kinds of respect. Respect is, most generally, a relation between a subject and an object, in which the subject responds to the object from a certain perspective in some appropriate way. Respect necessarily has an object. Respect is always for, directed toward, paid to, felt about, shown for some object. While a very wide variety of things can be appropriate objects of one kind of respect or another, the subject of respect is always a person, that is, a conscious rational being capable of recognizing things, being self-consciously and intentionally responsive to them, and having and expressing values with regard to them. Though animals may love or fear us, only persons can respect and disrespect us, or anything else. Respect is a responsive relation, and ordinary discourse about respect identifies four key elements of the response: attention, deference, valuing, and appropriate conduct. First, as suggested by its derivation from the Latin res facere, which means to look back at or to look again, respect is a particular mode of apprehending the object. The person who respects something perceives it differently from one who does not and responds to it in light of that perception. This perceptual element is common also to synonyms such as regard, from to watch out for, and consideration, examine, the stars, carefully. The idea of paying heed or giving proper attention to the object that is central to respect often means trying to see the object clearly, as it really is in its own right, and not simply seeing it through the filter of one's own interpretations, desires, fears, etc. Thus, respecting something contrasts with being oblivious, lacking conscious awareness, unmindful, or indifferent to it, ignoring or quickly dismissing it, neglecting or disregarding it, or carelessly or intentionally misidentifying it. An object can be perceived by a subject from a variety of perspectives. For example, one might rightly regard another human individual as a rights bearer, a judge, a superlative singer, a trustworthy person, or a threat to one's security. The respect one gives her in each case will be different, yet all will involve careful attention to her as she really is as a judge, threat, etc. It is in virtue of this aspect of careful attention that respect is sometimes thought of as an epistemic virtue. As responsive, respect is object-generated rather than subject-generated, something that is owed to, called for, deserved, elicited, to call forth, draw out, or provoke, a reaction, for example, or claimed by the object. Respect involves an experience, the experience that one must pay attention and respond appropriately. It thus is motivational. It is the recognition of something as directly determining our will without reference to what is wanted by our inclinations. In this way, respect differs from, for example, liking and fearing, which have their sources in the subject's interests or desires. When we respect something, we heed its call, accord it its due, acknowledge its claim to our attention. Thus, respect involves deference, in the most basic sense of yielding. Self-absorption and egocentric concerns give way to consideration of the object, one's motives and feelings submit to the object's reality. But this deference is not erasure of the self, for respect is at the same time an expression of action. It is deliberate, a matter of directed rather than grabbed attention, of reflective consideration and willingness to obey, and we are free to refuse to heed the call. The respectful response is regarded by the subject as deserved by the object or owed to or appropriate to it. The object, that is perceived as rightfully claiming attentive response in virtue of what or how it is itself. Respect thus involves believing that there is some feature of or fact about the object that warrants this response. This feature or fact is the ground or basis in the object, that in virtue of which it calls for respect. The basis gives us a reason to respect the object. It may also indicate more precisely how to respect it. Respect is thus reason governed. We cannot respect a particular object for just any old reason or for no reason at all. Rather, we respect an object for the reason that it has, in our judgment, a certain respect warranting characteristic, that it is, in our view, the kind of object that calls for that kind of response. And these reasons are categorical, in the sense that their weight or stringency does not depend on the subject's interests, goals, or desires, hence acting against these reasons, other things equal, is wrong. Respect is thus both subjective and objective. It is subjective in that the subject's response is constructed from her understanding of the object, its characteristics, the legitimacy of its call, and how fittingly to address the call. An individual's respect for an object can thus be inappropriate or unwarranted, for the object may not have the features she takes it to have, or the features she takes to be respect warranting might not be, or her idea of how properly to treat the object might be mistaken. But, as object generated, the logic of respect is the logic of objectivity and universality, in four ways. First, in respecting an object, we respond to it not as an extension of feelings, desires, and interests we already have, but as something whose significance is independent of us. Second, we experience the object as unconditionally constraining our attitudes and actions. Third, our reasons for respecting something are, we logically have to assume, reasons for other people to respect it, or at least to endorse our respect for it from a common point of view. Respect is thus an impersonal response to the object. Fourth, respect is universalizing, in the sense that if X is a respect-warranting feature of object Y, then respecting Y on account of X commits us, other things equal, to respecting other things that also have feature X. In respect, then, subjectivity defers to objectivity. There are many different reasons why objects warrant respect. Some are dangerous or powerful, and so respect can be like fear, or submission. Other things have authority over us, so respect can be like obedience. But respect is most commonly thought of as a mode of valuing. In particular, respect is one mode of experiencing and acknowledging the intrinsic value or significance of something. To respect something, at least, for some kinds of respect, it is to appreciate it as having worth or importance that is independent of our antecedent, a preceding occurrence, cause, or event, desires or commitments. Thus, we can respect things we don't like or agree with, such as our enemies or someone else's opinion. As a valuing response, respect involves having and acting from attitudes of positive valuing. In this regard, respect is like esteem and admiration, veneration and reverence, love and honor, while regarding something as utterly worthless or insignificant or disdaining or having contempt for it is incompatible with respecting it. Respect also aims to value its object appropriately, so it contrasts with degradation and discounting. The kinds of valuing that respect involves also contrast with other forms of valuing, such as promoting or using. Indeed, regarding a person merely as useful, treating her as just a sexual object, an ATM machine, a research subject, is commonly identified as a central form of disrespect for persons, and many people decry the killing endangered wild animals for their tusks or hides as despicably disrespectful of nature. Respect is sometimes identified as a feeling. It is typically the experiencing of something as valuable that is in focus in these cases. Finally, respect is generally regarded as having a behavioral component. In respecting an object, we often consider it to be making legitimate claims on our conduct as well as our thoughts and feelings. Here, respect involves refraining from certain treatment or acting only in particular ways in connection with it, ways that are regarded as deserved by, appropriate to, or owed to the object. And there are very many ways to respect things, keeping our distance from them, helping them, praising or honoring them, obeying or abiding by them, not violating or interfering with them, destroying them in some ways rather than letting them be destroyed in others, protecting or being careful with them, talking about them in ways that reflect their worth or status, mourning them, nurturing them. At the very least, respect involves regarding the object as, by its nature, for example, as of worth, giving us good reason to constrain our behavior. Respect is more than merely respectful behavior, however, for one can show respect that one does not have. For example, a teen may disdain adults and yet behave respectfully toward her friend's parents in a scheme to get the car, but she manipulates rather than respects them. To be a form or expression of respect, behavior has to be motivated by one's acknowledgement of the object as calling for that behavior, and it has to be motivated directly by consideration that the object is what it is, without reference to one's own interests and desires. On the other hand, certain kinds of feelings would not count as respect if they did not find expression in behavior or involved no dispositions to behave in certain ways rather than others, and if they did not spring from the beliefs, perceptions, and judgments that the object is worthy or calls for such behavior. As thus analyzed, respect, most generally, has cognitive, having a basis in or reducible to empirical factual knowledge, dimensions, beliefs, acknowledgments, judgments, deliberations, commitments, affective dimensions, emotions, feelings, ways of experiencing things, and cognitive dimensions, motivations, dispositions to act and forbear from acting. Some forms of respect also have valuational dimensions. On this analysis, then, respect is, most centrally, an attitude, or more broadly, since additional attitudes might be involved in respecting something, respect is a complex way of being towards something. Actions and modes of treatment typically count as respect insofar as they either manifest an attitude of respect or are of a sort through which the attitude of respect is characteristically expressed. A principle of respect is one that, logically, must be adopted by someone with the attitude of respect or that prescribes the attitude or actions that express it. Kinds of respect. That it is the nature of the object that determines its respect worthiness, and that there are different kinds of objects calling for correspondingly different kinds of attention, attitudes, and action has led many philosophers to argue that there are different kinds of respect. In what follows, three sets of distinctions will be discussed. Speculating on the historical development of the idea that all persons as such deserve respect, and using terms found on Achtung, the German word usually translated as respect, identifies three distinct concepts for which respect has been the name. Respect is the uneasy and watchful attitude that has the element of fear in it. Its objects are dangerous things or things with power over the subject. It is respect that woodworkers are encouraged to have for power tools, that a city dweller might have for street gangs, a new sailor might be admonished to have for the sea, a child might have for an abusive parent. Respect contrasts with contemptuous disregard. It is shown in conduct that is cautious, self-protective, other-placating. Observantia is the moralized analog of respect, It involves regarding the object as making a rightful claim on our conduct, as deserving moral consideration in its own right, independently of considerations of personal well-being. It is observantia that historically was extended first to classes of non-dangerous but otherwise worthy people and then to all persons as such, regardless of merit or ability. Observantia encompasses both the respect said to be owed to all humans equally and the forms of polite respect and deference that acknowledge different social positions. Reverentia is the special feeling of profound awe and respect we have in the presence of something extraordinary or sublime, a feeling that both humbles and uplifts us. The moral law and people who exemplify it in morally worthy actions elicit reverentia, is the special feeling of profound awe and respect we have in the presence of something extraordinary or sublime, a feeling that both humbles and uplifts us. From us, for we experience the law or its exemplification as something that always trumps our inclinations in determining our wills. The different forms of power as underlying the three kinds of respect. In each case, respect is the acknowledgement of the power of something other than ourselves to demand, command, or make claims on our attention, consideration and deference. A fourfold distinction among kinds of respect, according to the basis in the objects. Consider the following sets of examples: A. Respecting a colleague highly as a scholar and having a lot of respect for someone with guts. B. A mountain climber's respect for the elements and a tennis player's respect for her opponent's strong backhand. C. respecting the terms of an agreement and respecting a person's rights, and D. showing respect for a judge by rising when she enters the courtroom and respecting a worn-out flag by burning it rather than tossing it in the trash. The respect in A. evaluative respect is similar to other favorable attitudes such as esteem and admiration. It is earned or deserved, or not, depending on whether and to the degree that the object is judged to meet certain standards. Obstacle respect, in B, is a matter of regarding the object as something which, if not taken proper account of in one's decisions about how to act, could prevent one from achieving one's ends. The objects of C, directive respect are directives, things such as requests, rules, advice, laws, or rights claims that may be taken as guides to action. One respects a directive when one's behaviors intentionally comply with it. The objects of D, institutional respect are social institutions or practices, the positions or roles defined within an institution or practice, and persons or things that occupy the positions or represent the institution. Institutional respect is shown by behavior that conforms to rules that prescribe certain conduct as respectful. These four forms of respect differ in several ways. Each identifies a quite different kind of feature of objects as the basis of respect. Each is expressed in action in quite different ways, although evaluative respect need not be expressed at all. One can have institutional respect for an institution, for example, the criminal justice system, without showing it for a particular element of it, the judge in this trial. And directive respect is not an attitude that one might or might not express, but a mode of conduct motivated by a recognition of the directive's authority. Evaluative respect centrally involves having a favorable attitude toward the object, while the other forms do not. Directive respect does not admit of degrees, one either obeys the rule or doesn't, but the others do. We can have more evaluative respect for one person than another. This distinction to argue that respect for persons is not a unique kind of respect but should be conceived rather as involving some combination or other of these four. The fourfold classification, the fifth form, care respect, which is exemplified in an environmentalist's deep respect for nature. Care respect involves regarding the object as having profound and perhaps unique value and so cherishing it, and perceiving it as fragile or calling for special care and so acting or forbearing to act out of felt benevolent concern for it. This analysis of respect draws explicitly from a feminist ethics of care and has been influential in feminist and non-feminist discussions of respecting persons as unique, particular individuals. The other two kinds of respect, recognition respect and appraisal respect. Recognition respect is the disposition to give appropriate weight or consideration in one's practical deliberations to some fact about the object and then to act accordingly. Also referred as consideration respect. A wide variety of objects, including laws, dangerous things, someone's feelings, social institutions, nature, the individuals present in different contexts, and persons as such, can be objects of recognition respect. Appraisal respect, by contrast, is an attitude of positive appraisal of a person or their merits, which are features of persons that manifest excellence of character. Individuals can be the objects of appraisal respect either as persons or as engaged in some pursuit or occupying some role. Evaluation is always done in light of some qualitative standards, and different standards can apply to one and the same individual. Thus, appraisal respect is a matter of degree, depending on the extent to which the object meets the standards. So, we can respect someone more or less highly and respect one person more highly than another, and it can coexist with some negative assessments of an individual or her traits, judged in light of other standards. We can have appraisal respect for someone's honesty even while thinking her lazy, and we can highly respect someone else as altogether a morally fine person. We can respect an individual as an excellent teacher or carpenter yet regard her as far from a moral exemplar. Appraisal respect, which is based on assessment of character traits, from esteem, another attitude of positive assessment whose wider basis include any features in virtue of which one can think well of someone. However, other philosophers treat esteem and appraisal, respect as synonyms. The recognition-appraisal distinction has been quite influential and is widely regarded as the fundamental distinction. If it is, then it should encompass the other distinctions, although some fine-tuning might be necessary. And indeed, evaluative respect and perhaps reverentia for morally good persons are essentially the same as appraisal respect, while respect, obstacle respect, observantia, directive respect, institutional respect and care respect can be analyzed as forms of recognition respect. Some philosophers, however, have found the recognition, appraisal distinction to be inadequate. Neither reverentia for the moral law nor the felt experience of reverential respect for the sublimity of persons as such are forms of appraisal respect, yet because recognition respect is analyzed, first, as holding only in deliberative contexts, and second, as not essentially involving feeling. Reverentia seems also not to be a form of recognition respect. Moreover, while valuing the object is not essential to some forms of recognition respect, for example, directive respect, and is only indirectly involved in other forms, in obstacle respect, we don't value the obstacle but do value the goal it blocks us from reaching. Valuing is essential to some forms of respect. In particular, valuing persons intrinsically is widely regarded as the core of the respect that all persons are thought to be owed simply as persons. However, it is not sufficient simply to gloss recognition respect as recognizing the value of the object, for one can recognize the value of something and yet not value it, as an insurance appraiser does, or take the value of something, say, a person's child, into account in deliberating about how best to revenge oneself on that person. Respect for some categories of objects is not just a matter of taking the object's value into consideration but of valuing the object, and valuing it intrinsically. Analyzing appraisal respect as just the positive assessment of someone's character traits as good is similarly problematic, for one can evaluate something highly and yet not value it. For example, one can appraise someone's moral performance as stellar and hate or envy her for precisely that reason. Respect in the appraisal sense is not just evaluating but also valuing the object positively. The recognition-appraisal distinction thus seems to obscure another very important distinction between what we might call valuing respect and non-valuing respect. Appraisal respect is a form of valuing respect, but recognition respect includes both valuing and non-valuing forms. There are, of course, different modes of valuing, and at least three sets of distinctions are relevant to respect: a) between moral and non-moral valuing, or valuing from a moral or a non-moral point of view; b) between comparative and non-comparative valuing; and c) between valuing intrinsically, valuing it in itself, apart from valuing anything else, and valuing extrinsically, for example, because of its relation to something else of value. A complete account of respect would need to work out a taxonomy, the classification of organisms in an ordered system that indicates natural relationships, that incorporates these valuing distinctions. In what follows, however, we'll use the terms recognition respect, evaluative respect, and reverential respect, the last for the valuing feeling that is motivational without being deliberative, specifying the valuing dimensions as necessary. In everyday discourse, the valuing sense of respect, especially when used about people, most commonly means thinking highly of someone, that is, evaluative respect. However, philosophical attention to respect has tended to focus on recognition, or, sometimes, reverential respect that acknowledges or values the object from a moral point of view. These discussions tend to relate such respect to the concepts of moral standing or of moral worth. Moral standing, or moral considerability, is the idea that certain things matter morally in their own right and so are appropriate objects of direct fundamental moral consideration or concern. Some form of recognition respect is, on some accounts, a primary mode of such moral consideration. Alternatively, it is argued that certain things have a distinctive kind of intrinsic and incomparable moral worth or value, often called dignity, in virtue of which they ought to be accorded some valuing form of moral recognition or reverential respect. Discussions that focus on moral standing or moral worth address questions such as, what things fall within the domain of basic moral consideration or have this distinctive moral worth? What confers moral standing on objects, or what is the basis of their moral worth? Are there different levels of moral standing and, if so, do objects at different levels warrant different modes of moral respect? And what sorts of treatment are constitutive of, express, or are compatible with such moral respect? In modern philosophical discussions, humans are universally regarded as the paradigm, a set of assumptions, concepts, values, and practices that constitutes a way of viewing reality for the community that shares them, especially in an intellectual discipline. Objects of moral respect, if anything has moral standing or dignity and so warrants respect, it is the individual human being. Although some theorists argue that nature, or all living beings, species, ecosystems, or societies, or cultures, traditions, also warrant the moral consideration and valuing of respect, most philosophical discussion of respect has focused on respect for persons. Respect for persons. People can be the objects or recipients of different forms of respect. We can, directive, respect a person's legal rights, show, institutional, respect for the president by calling him Mr. President, have a healthy, obstacle, respect for an easily angered person, care, respect someone by cherishing her in her concrete particularity, evaluatively, respect an individual for her commitment to a worthy project, and accord one person the same basic moral respect we think any person deserves. Thus the idea of respect for persons is ambiguous. Because both institutional respect and evaluative respect can be for persons in roles or position, the phrase respecting someone as a person might mean either having high regard for a person's excellent performance in the role or behaving in ways that express due consideration or deference to an individual of that position. Similarly, the phrase respecting someone as a person might refer to appraising her as overall a morally good person, or to acknowledging her standing as an equal in the moral community, or to attending to her as the particular person she is as opposed to treating her like just another body. In the literature of moral and political philosophy, the notion of respect for persons commonly means a kind of respect that all people are owed morally just because they are persons, regardless of social position, individual characteristics or achievements, or moral merit. The idea is that persons as such have a distinctive moral status in virtue of which we have special categorical obligations to regard and treat them in ways that are constrained by certain inviolable limits. This is sometimes expressed in terms of rights. Persons, it is said, have a fundamental moral right to respect simply because they are persons. And it is a commonplace that persons are owed or have a right to equal respect. It is obvious that we could not owe every individual evaluative respect, let alone equal evaluative respect, since not everyone acts morally correctly or has an equally morally good character. So, if it is true that all persons are owed or have a moral right to respect just as persons, then the concept of respect for person has to be analyzed as some form or combination of forms of recognition or reverential respect. For a variety of reasons, however, it is controversial whether we do indeed have a moral obligation to respect all persons, regardless of merit, and if so, why. There are disagreements, for example, about the scope of this claim, the grounds for respect, and the justification for the obligation. There is also a divergence of views about the kinds of treatment that are respectful of persons. Continued in Part 5. Thank you. Sincerely. Hussein Fahmy.